In today's video, I'm going to be sharing these 5 amazing tips for doors and windows in Revit. First, I'm going to be showing you how to create a complex opening for your families. Then I'm going to be showing you how to assign a proper category for each of the elements for doors and windows. Then we're going to be implementing shared parameters in order to create a wall thickness parameter, which we can schedule, and then we can send information to the manufacturer for all of the wall thicknesses for our doors and windows. Then I'm going to be showing you how to create a type catalog. And finally, we're going to be creating a template for our doors and windows families. Let's go. First, let me tell you about today's video sponsor, which is Galan Planner Software. This is a free software that you can use to generate any door or window family that you can imagine, and it's going to generate a family for you so you don't have to go and model it yourself. The families are high quality, detailed, and parametric, and you can create them simply by sketching out the general shape. Then we set the dimensions, we assign profiles and panels, and we even get this amazing 3D preview that can kind of be animated. It can also generate all of the specifications for all of the windows and doors in the project, so you can have all of the completed project documentation, and also you can easily order the exact families which you have created, or the exact windows and doors which you have created. I actually have a full dedicated tutorial on how to use this plugin. I'm going to link it up in the cards above and then also down in the description of this video. And if you want to check out the Galan Planner software, I'm going to be linking that up also in the cards above and below in the description of this video, so you can check it out for yourself. Okay, so now without any further ado, let's jump straight into Revit. Now let's talk about tip number 1, which is creating complex openings for our doors and windows. So here I have this window family. So this is just a simple generic window template, and we can see we have this opening. Now you can actually select the opening by hovering over the edge. Now here, if I go from the other side and I hover over the edge, it's just going to select the wall. However, if I come from this side and hover around the edge, you can see it's only going to highlight kind of an outline of this opening. And when you select it, it's going to say here opening cut. And you can see that here we have the option to edit sketch, and you can edit the sketch. However, the problem is, even when you edit the sketch, you can still only get a perpendicular cut. So it's only going to cut straight through the wall. However, if you want something a bit more complex, you can create this opening with a void. So let me show you. Let's say we want to create a window, but we only want to cut through the wall so far at the top part, so we can hide the blinders or something like that above the window. So for that, what I'm going to do is just delete this opening. Then I would go to, let's go to the one of the elevations. So let's go to the left elevation, for example, just like this. Go here to create void forms, and this will be a void extrusion. We can set the work plane if we want, so let's set it to the reference plane left, click OK, and then I'm going to create just a rectangle like this, lock it on all sides, and then I'm going to create something. So here's the exterior, so here I'm just going to alter this a little bit, so just like that, hit the escape key a couple of times, then go to trim and extend to corner and just fix it up here. And then finally I'm going to add a dimension just to hold this in place, so just like that, and here like this. Okay, so now we have this void created, and if I go to the 3D view, this is what that looks like. Hit finish, there we go. Now we can go back to our reference level, and now I'm just going to adjust this to go from one side to the other. Again, make sure to lock everything in place, and now when we go to the 3D view, we can just make the cut by going here to cut the geometry, select the wall, select the void, and this is what we get. So now we have this complex cut into the wall, so it's only going to cut wall at certain places with different depths of the cut. And of course you can make this even more complicated if you want when you have more complex windows. Now let's talk about tip number two, which is going to be assigning proper categories to all of our door or window elements. So here I have this door, and if I select any of the elements in the 3D view, like this door panel, for example, here in the properties panel, if I scroll down, we have under identity data the subcategory parameter. Now here I've already set this to panel, and if I expand this, you can see with the door template, we can see that we have the option for elevation swing, frame, mullion, glass, opening, panel, and plan swing. So these are all of the categories that are available, and it's really important to set them up correctly. This also holds true for your ground level and all of the annotation elements like this plan swing. You can see that the subcategory is set to plan swing, and also if I go here to identity data, the subcategory is set to the same. And you can also have the plan swing and the plan swing cut. So all of these options are available here, and you can adjust them. Now, as I said, this is really important because then when you're in a project such as this one here, and you have all of the doors or windows loaded in, you can make broad changes across the project by changing those subcategories. So for example, in this case, if I go to visibility graphics, VG is the shortcut, and find doors, for example, here, expand the drop menu and find my plan swing, I can override the lines to be something like, let's use these dots, and then click OK, apply, OK, and now as you can see, I've made a basically a broad change that's going to affect all of the doors in this particular view. Obviously, if I wanted to make a change across the entire project, I would do the same change, but here in the object styles. But if the categories aren't set correctly, or the subcategories aren't set correctly in the families themselves, well, then you will not be able to make those changes in the project. Now let's move to tip number three, and that's going to be using shared parameters for wall thicknesses. So if you don't know about shared parameters, I have an entire video on how to set those up, and I'm going to link it up in the cards above so you can check it out there. Now I'm going to be showing you how I've used a wall thickness shared parameter in this project to get a report of all of the wall thicknesses for each of my individual doors. So here you can see I have this project, we have different walls at different thicknesses, and I have doors on each of those. Now, if I open up one of the door families, you can see that here in the parameters, I have this reporting parameter called wall thickness. So this is just giving me a report of how thick the wall is on the family itself. Now, with that parameter set up, obviously it's a shared parameter, I can come here to the project now, and I can go to the project browser, go to schedule quantities, right click, create a new schedule, and this will be a door schedule. And let's click OK. And here I'm just going to go with the simple ones. So let's go with family type, and then also I'm going to find my wall thickness shared parameter and load that in as well. Click OK, and now what you'll see is I have for each of these doors, I have the wall thickness reporting here. So I can send this information to the door manufacturer so they can easily manufacture all of the doors and have them fit to the correct wall where they're supposed to be at. Now let's talk about tip number four, and that is using a type catalog. So whenever you're using families in Revit, it's a good idea to have a type catalog. So for example, here I have this family, a basic door family. If I load this into my project, you can see that this will load in multiple types. Now in this case, this is perfectly fine. I'm happy with having multiple types for this particular family, but let's say we have a family that might have hundreds of types. You obviously don't want to load those in. It's going to make the project heavier and it's going to make the navigation a lot more difficult. So what you would do in that case is, if I just go back a few steps, okay, you want to create a type catalog. So let me bring this family up and I'm just going to open up this family. And when you open up the family, you go here to family types. You can see here we have all of the family types. And now we can export a family type catalog by going here to file, export, and then here we have family types. And I can just export that wherever you want. I'm just going to save it on my desktop where my family is. I'm just going to leave it like this. So as you can see, it's just a simple text file and it only needs to be with the family itself. And now when I go back to my project and I want to load in that family, unfortunately, I cannot just drag it over. I need to go here to insert, load family, and then let's go to desktop. And here I have that family, and just because that family type catalog file is here with the family at the same place, when I hit open, I'm going to get this family type catalog, and then I can even use all of these filters to filter down my family parameters, and then I can just pick out the one that I want to use. So let's say here I want only these two, I click OK. And then if I go here to the door family, you can see only two types have been loaded in, and that's going to save me a lot of time searching for the exact types. And finally, for our tip number five, I'm going to be showing you how you can create a template for your families. So let's say you're working in Revit and you want to create multiple versions of a certain family. It makes sense to have a template to start from. Now, here I have this window and I've just created this window frame. And let's say I'm going to create many windows that are going to be using this particular window frame, or it might be a set of parameters which I have created. Well, in that case, I can just come and save this as a template. However, if I go here to the save button and let's save this on desktop as family test and hit save. But before I hit save, as you can see, I only have the RFA. So that's the Revit family type of file. I cannot really save this as a RFT, which is the Revit family template file. However, if I just save it as this RFA file, hit save, and then I can just close this up. What you'll notice is if I just open up my desktop, here I have that family, and you need to make sure that under view, you've went to show and make sure that file name extension is checked on. So we can see the file name extension here, and I can just come in here and I can, instead of A, I can place AT, hit save. It's going to give me a warning saying that this might ruin the file. I accept that risk. And now if I want to create a new family and I have to pick out a template, I can go to my desktop and I can pick this family up, hit open, and it's going to use that family as a template because I've changed that one letter and now Revit recognizes this as a family template. So that's going to conclude all of the tips for today. If you want to check out my Revit courses, I suggest you go to balkanarchitect.com. I'm going to link it up in the cards above and also down in the description. There I've got over 140 hours of content and I'm adding more each month. Thank you for watching, guys. Make sure to check out my website, balkanarchitect.com, for more Revit courses. There I have over 120 hours of content, and I'm adding more each week. Make sure to subscribe for more videos, and also I've added a video over there that might interest you as well.